So here we are again at the Green Meadow Waldorf School. Mm. And of course, the mystery plays are going on. Mm. And maybe how we can start is maybe you can tell me your name.
Marke Levene.
Okay. Marke, of course, I've known you for many years, but the people on the internet haven't.
No, quite.
Some of them haven't. And what I'd like to do is see where the turning points were in your life. How did you come to the point where you are now? In other words, of course, and mention along the way all the kind of wonderful things that you've done, of course, and the wonderful things you're going to be doing. So, all right, so.
How much time do we have?
We have until 7:30.
No, I see. Well, as I think you may remember, I've actually had a somewhat unique biography.
Childhood.
I was an orphan, and so I'm adopted and when I'm three, and the family that adopted me, my adopted father was a prop man at Paramount Studios in Hollywood. And I went up to visit him in Wyoming when they were making the movie Shane. And the assistant director said, "What a precocious child," to my adopted parents. "Why don't you get him an agent?" And therein lies a tale. So I really was in the 50s and 60s. I was the leading child character actor in Hollywood. And also I came to New York. I did everything broadcast basically in the 50s and 60s. Playhouse 90, Studio Ones, Climax, Rin Tin Tin, Circus Boys, Sergeant Preston of the Yukon, The Real McCoys, Bengal Lancers, Gunsmoke,
wow.
I Love Lucy.
Oh my gosh.
The list goes on. I was in a series for 3 years. I basically didn't go to school. I really grew up in the studios. I did go to school, but then I'd be gone for weeks.
Parents were with you?
My mother would always come she would have to be at the studio until I turned 16, and then of course it changed.
I
have my own section in the History of Television Museum with Charlton Heston as my father and Nancy Reagan when she was Nancy Smith before she married Ronald Reagan as my mother.
Wow.
You know, and there's stories like John Wayne taught me how to play bridge when I was working on the movie in Mexico with him and Dean Martin, and that's a whole other story. But anyway, all of that, of course, led me to, along the way, I had already inwardly become actively interested in just my own inner life as well as this outer phenomena. And I ended up really getting drafted in 1965 because I didn't study to get an exemption and ended up going into the Army and spent a year in Vietnam. And when I came back from Vietnam, I was having trouble with my digestion and I was already open to non-chemical medical solutions and found my way to this doctor in Beverly Hills who was helping me, and I knew he was fine, and I was happy with it, and he had two pictures on the wall. One was the Christ, I knew who that was, and the other was this funny guy with the silk tie.
That
was Rudolf Steiner. And
wow.
So he told me, and I then went to the esoteric bookstore in Los
How
Angeles.
How old were you at that point?
About 22, somewhere around there, and bought a copy of Occult Science and read it over the weekend and said, aha, this is something I have to pay attention to. And that actually really began. I then more and more read anthroposophy, you know, on my own. I never really had anything to do with it. I occasionally would have a brief conversation with the librarian at the Anthroposophical Library in Los Angeles, but really never was involved in any activity. And I was still reading other esoteric thought, but kind of brought me to a major crossing point, which was for me in 1972, and I'm 26 at that point, and I had gone into a period where I was doing yoga, and I was living in an ashram, and I was being very pious and holy and chanting and no meat and just no
sleeping on a mat
so,
and
oh,
stuff
yes,
like
I mean,
that.
Just straight to heaven, right? And it was Swami Satchidananda, and he came to Los Angeles. And we were all sitting on the front lawn of this place, and people were asking him questions. And I was quite stunned that none of my questions were their questions. And I realized that they were not asking questions about their own inner development. They were actually asking questions about a conception of the world spiritually that brought about the conditions. And so I was then even more surprised that I knew the answers before Satchidananda said anything. And then, of course, I realized it because I had been reading Rudolf Steiner for years. And if the esoteric roots are in truth, then all right, the language is different, some of the pictures are different, but the core principles of the nature of the fact that we're both a physical and a spiritual being was evident. And the one thing Satchitananda said that day, which went into the depth of my soul, was the man who digs many water never finds water. And within 48 hours I was gone, and I've never looked back since. I realized that the well I needed to dig was anthroposophy.
Yeah, yeah.
And shortly after that I met Barbara, my wife. We've been together now for 40 years. And through a whole series of events we eventually found our way really on the East Coast in Boston to our first experience of eurythmy and actually meeting a community of people, and eventually went on to England to study eurythmy, which we did at the London School.
Who did she study with?
She went to London School as well.
Okay,
so,
okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And
so the both of you did that?
Yes, we both.
Were you actually in the same class?
We started in the same class, but then we had our daughter and she had to stop. So it took her about 8 years to get through the four. And
yeah,
I'm not that sure that isn't a good way to do it, as far as I can tell in retrospect.
Well,
not rushing is has its value.
Yeah.
But then while I was in England, of course, I created Portal Productions, which was the company in the English-speaking world. We toured all over the Northern Hemisphere. Mm-hmm. We actually did 51 performances of the fourth play in our tour, including...
Do you have any films of that?
I have some video that was really just done with a camera sitting. It's anecdotal. It's not really anything mm-hmm. that should mm-hmm. even be posted in. Yeah, we have some bits and pieces, but and then we in 1997 we came, but we lived in England for 16 years, and then in 97 we came back to the U.S. and moved to the West
yeah,
Coast.
Yeah, but you're missing something. The Soul's Awakening.
Yeah, that was just saying we did 51 performances of the Soul's Awakening in 94 and 95. We
exactly,
toured, which is where we met.
Yeah,
I'm very grateful in retrospect. Remember
yeah.
for all of your help, and we came to Toronto.
Yeah, yeah,
and so,
yeah, yeah.
You know, but we toured all four plays in English. And each time the tours got bigger, and we did in 95.
51 performances.
51 performances.
In how many different countries?
12, I believe. 12 countries, yeah.
How?
We toured for 6 months all over the Northern Hemisphere.
Mm-hmm. With how many people?
The touring company was 45.
Wow.
Yeah.
I remember when you came to Toronto and we had this theater.
The church.
Yeah, the
church.
And we
turned into a theater.
And, oh my God.
Yeah.
I mean, it was magic.
Well, theater is magic.
Magic.
If it's well done, it is magic.
It is, isn't it? It
yeah,
is, isn't it? So then you came back to the United States. What was the reason for that?
Well, I had also created a manufacturing company while I was in Britain, and that had really gone into Camp Hill because the whole production was anachronistic, and then we did the Portal Productions grew to this whole tour, and that came to a close. We realized that was ending as a phenomenon,
mm-hmm.
the eight
mm-hmm.
years of Portal Productions.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter had finished her English A-levels and decided to come to university here in America. My wife, Barbara, had gone to Dornach to spend a year working with some eurythmists in Dornach.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I had to go somewhere, and I decided I would go back home to California.
Yeah,
So... then really the kind of the next high point was
Dvořák.
Basically it was my initiative that created the tour throughout America.
The North American tour.
You know, of the Dvořák's New World Symphony, which was the first time in 27 years that full orchestral... But that leads us to the next point.
And yes.
That's really where things are now. And that's, of course, I'm so grateful that I could be supportive of Barbara's work to do this play here.
Yeah, yeah. Tell me a little bit about what you've actually been doing within the play.
Well, I'm speaking the guardian and the gnomes, but
mm-hmm.
really probably more it's the fact that I have a lot of experience with touring
theater.
And I could support them moving from what has been home for decades
exactly.
into this new theater, which
yeah.
I think from my perspective, there's a breath in this theater isn't there.
Yeah.
But just the fact that I know how to do things and I could support people with my know-how.
Yeah, sound and lighting and how
with,
to put
with
it all.
Lighting techniques, with set design. I just have a lot of experience. And so, you know, that's basically my life has been one of accumulation of experience. I don't, you know, not possessions, but experiences.
What about, though, connection to different parts in the drama? In other words, is there anything that you particularly identify with yourself in your own soul?
No,
about spirit and soul.
Well,
you know?
I think in any given week there'll be moments when I'll feel somewhat like Capasius.
Yeah.
There'll be times when I feel like Johannes, and then I long to have the hawk of Theodora.
Yeah.
Actually, still today, the character of Theodora can just make me. It's just so remarkable.
Yeah.
And wanting to be Benedictus. I don't actually go there very well. I go to a lot of other places. And then the depth of love of Maria and her holy solemn vow. I mean, I actually find that over the years, it is so often that I talk to someone and the best explanation I can of the phenomena of the soul spiritual question around whatever the issue is, I can make reference back to the dramas. Not the one. Mm-hmm. You have a lifetime of reading Rudolf Steiner. You have so many kind of iconic thoughts that you hold on to.
Yeah.
But somewhere the dramas touch straight into the soul life.
Yeah.
And so for me, it's been interesting that over the years I knew I wasn't my task to carry forward with the dramas. It really, I was supportive of other people. People would sometimes ask me to do a workshop or a study group, which I did over the years. But it's really Barbara's work now has pulled me back in, but that's because of this new initiative of mine. And ultimately, the eurythmia has to be yours. So I've just been very open to whomever I could find that had knowledge. And so for me, the question is, is the inner imaginative alive? If the inner imaginative is alive, then the physical will go where it should be.
Yeah.
And you need to, of course, know how to go there.
Yeah.
But it's, from my standpoint, it's not just a question of, it isn't just a question of saying, well, now here, this is a B flat. No, it's only a B flat because your heart is singing.
Is in it.
Is singing the B flat. Yeah. And then the gesture has reality, has meaning. Somebody asked me, why aren't you in Europe? And I said, well, we really don't have the money. And she wrote me a check. And so that's why we went to Europe.
And so there you go. So you don't
times
need to
were
be...
different then. Yeah, though. People did those things years ago. That
amazing,
doesn't happen very much like
amazing.
That anymore.
Yeah. So how has the... has because you live eurythmia, how does that live into what you do?
I think it affects everything I do. I mean, I just, you know, the whole, well, it's, okay, I'll use as an example. You saw when you opened up and you saw scene 5 and 6 with that gesture. Well, that was just straight out of my feeling. How did I make the space do this beautiful, Actually, it's not quite an awe because I purposefully had it rounded, so maybe it's a bit more towards out of that into more of fulfillment, so that the whole stage, and didn't it look
and slanted? I mean,
but it was just the whole feeling of the way we did, the way we used those gauzes, and it's just, I mean, for me, I everything now becomes a reflection of what's the inner feeling of the gesture of at all levels and in all ways. I've only gotten healthier as I've gotten older. It's somewhere coming all the way in through the eurythmia got rid of all kinds of aches and pains that I used to. I'm getting old now, so aches and pains are coming back, but that comes because I'm getting old. But still, really, a lot of places, I've just gotten healthier as my life has gone on. I'm sure that was from doing the eurythmia.
Me too.
I think it would help the eurythmy world if they actually would start from the standpoint that they're performing artists and would teach people how to, that actually they're stage artists. How many eurythmists know the difference between moving up left to down right versus up right to down left? They've never even heard of it.
No.
And we don't get to rewrite the rules of existence, even if we're using a clear sense of the etheric as the basis of our movement.
Mm-hmm.
We still, if we're going to be stage artists, have to be stage artists.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I think there's a lot of things like that that could be done. But having said that, it's tougher for people to have the time. Even when I did it, you could set aside 4 years in which nothing else happened. That's so hard for people today.
I know.
The world has changed so much.
That imagination would have to be the biggest part of it.
I think that's the essence. I don't think you can actually get real access to the etheric without proper imagination development.
Yeah.
Rudolf Steiner suggests that the closest that you can come to clairvoyant thought with your normal thinking faculties is in the realm of pure thought as manifest in something like projective geometry.
Mm-hmm.
By its very nature, without even having to get into the mathematical side. But if you take it from an artistic side, it actually leads you to that point. I used to do that course for many years in Toronto.
Oh, yes, you came to Toronto, yes.
Yeah, for years and years.
Oh, yeah. Where are you going to... What is in the future? What's happening?
Well, there was a new project. So maybe
you can tell.
Yeah, a week after we finished the run of The Soul's Awakening in 95, I was in my office in King's Langley in England. And in a moment which lasted maybe an hour, I could actually see the next play. I knew the indications of Rudolf Steiner for what he would have done in 1914, but that had to be canceled in Munich because it had been in August and the war had begun.
Yeah.
And I could see it, and I outlined it. It was a 6-page outline. And I mentioned it to a few friends, realized this was not the time, and I put it away. And through a whole series of remarkable experiences about 2 years ago, it came back as a question, because I was saying to my Barbara, that I felt I had one more big one left in me this lifetime, but I just didn't know what it was. And this came back, and when it came back, things just suddenly started to line up.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a meeting in April of last year in London, a group of us, I had one meeting in February with some of people from Portal Productions.
Uh-huh.
And the feeling was somehow maybe this was the time. And once I sent the outline to a handful of friends,
mm-hmm.
everyone said, oh my God, they
yes.
now can see the next play, imaginatively.
Yeah.
And so we had this meeting in London and we spent 2 days together. And that's Kim Snyder-Vine, Duncan McIntosh, Matthew Dexter, as he's known in the English-speaking world, who's in Barbara's production, and Jeff Norris, and myself, and then the only other person who I sent it to who couldn't come was Michael Burton, but he's in New Zealand.
Oh, okay.
And so basically everyone said they were prepared. They could stand behind the idea that there was enough in it. Then the question was, who was going to write it, how are we going to do it, all the manifold questions that come from such an idea. And Burton's first reaction was, what are you doing? You can't put the old band back together. That was the 90s. These are the 12s or wherever we are, what are
right.
you doing? You know?
Yeah.
And 17 years have gone by. And Michael and I, though, in the 90s, we worked together. And I did a one-man tour all over Europe and America.
Yeah, I saw
Beethoven.
It. Yeah. I actually saw it.
Oh, really? Where did you
see it? In Toronto.
Really?
I wished I had filmed that one.
Actually,
were just absolutely fantastic.
I remember doing it in Toronto.
Yeah.
And I remember some of the teachers in the school saying, we don't need speakers, electronics, and stuff.
No.
Because I know how to speak.
Oh, yeah, of course,
so,
of course.
It wasn't the building. It was what
it
you
was
do.
Amazing.
Yeah. Anyway, so, Michael, I've always had a good connection.
You should do that
Michael.
Again, just for the fun of it.
Oh, I don't know.
My goodness.
Well,
so was he.
This would be about the right time.
I would say. Yeah.
Then Michael couldn't sleep. He woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning and he started to write. And he said, he sent me some things. I said, Michael, I'm going to have questions. None of it matters. Just keep writing.
Just keep doing it.
Just keep writing. Don't talk to anybody. Don't show it to anybody. I'm not going to discuss what you're writing. Just keep writing. Don't worry about
it. Good idea. Good idea.
And he did it. It took him 7 months, and he wrote the play.
Yeah.
Artistically, it's the right thing. If you're inspired, go.
Then you do it.
Okay, then we'll come back. We'll correct. We'll adjust. We'll change.
Sure,
we'll edit.
Sure,
and we're actually in
and
that
as
process.
You play it, you find out what needs it.
And then we'll
it.
Discover other things, of
yeah,
course.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
So then we had a meeting. The retrospective scenes, which was the indication for Rudolf Steiner, would be at the Castelli Springs in Delphi in Greece,
uh-huh.
which is actually where the Oracle was in Greece. And so we, in April, 4 months ago, whatever it is, a group of us from around the world actually met in Delphi and spent 5 days together working our way through Michael's play, and everybody basically says they're both artistically and spiritually willing to stand behind
it.
And everybody who's read it, I gave a copy to Barbara.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And others, Sophia Walsh, if you know who she
yes,
is.
Yes, of course, course I know, yeah.
You know, that's basically everyone says
yes.
it's true. And yeah. we need to refine it. There's issues, but fundamentally the imagination is
it's
one.
There.
So I'm going to go to a couple of key points. The anthroposophical performing arts, from my standpoint, are in a deep existential crisis.
Yes.
Today, there are basically only 12 eurythmists in the entire planet that can live as artists. And there are virtually no speech artists left. This is impossible. This is a pathway to oblivion. You have to have a certain amount, number of people, enough that there are people who the only question is this an F or an F sharp? That is the most, you have to have a certain, teaching is important. I've taught for many years. I don't question it. But there has to be a certain core of people whose lives are centered around the art itself.
Yes.
And without that, there's no real future.
Yeah.
And my hope is to actually make a gesture that changes both the internal culture and the anthroposophical world and allows us to build some new bridges to the outer world. We don't have all the artistic solutions for everybody, but when it comes to threshold questions and spiritual questions and a sense of integrity
yes,
about
yes.
truth, goodness, and beauty,
yeah.
we actually hold that and can hold our place as we know on stage when it's well done.
For sure.
And so the idea is we're going to create festivals around the world with the new mystery drama, Tour in Repertory, A Midsummer Night's Dream, and a symphonic eurythmy performance, and we will go from 1 to 3 weeks, depending upon audience potential, in cities all over the world, and basically mm-hmm. say, we are here.
Yeah.
And to find out more, you go to workingofthespirit.com.
There you
workingofthespirit.com. And there okay. you can stay updated as this develops. But basically, the hope is to change the culture that gives us some new bridges to the future, so that some of the young talent that you see
yes.
here
oh, yeah.
has the possibility to actually have
do
somewhere.
That.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at now.
So now I know why I came to Spring Valley.
Well, it's nice to see you again. It's been a while.
Yeah, but I mean, because this has to get out.
Yes, it does.
So I'm going to put it all on YouTube.
I need your help to get it out.
There we go. All right.